I'm Julia. I work at a company called Stripe where I work on the machine learning team. So just to get a sense for the audience here, who like builds like models, like statistical models or like machine learning models? Some of you. Who doesn't? Okay. So for the people who do, I'm going to like tell you a lot of opinions about how I think you should do your job. For people who don't, I want to give you a sense of like what like working on machine learning like in the terms of like a production system where like your model has to actually do stuff, like what that process looks like. So this talk has a lot of other titles. One of them is how to not cry when someone asks you about something you built 2 months ago and how well it performs compared to what you're doing now. Also proving that they're paying you for a reason. We're going to get to no more handcrafted artisanal data visualizations. So the context I'm going to be talking about this in is I work in industry at a company. The models are part of a system that needs to work, and they need to be maintained long-term. So this talk is not about like how to train a model or like how building new models is fun. It is. Or like changing the world with computers, which, sure. Or like new exciting machine learning algorithms. It's not about any of those things. It's also not about things that are hard about machine learning, like data cleaning and like all of this stuff. What it is about is two things. One is that evaluating your models matters, because your stuff has to actually work. So I'm going to like rant about that for some amount of time. And then because I hate it when people rant at me about what they think I should be doing without actually telling me like something concrete they can do, I'm going to give you something concrete you can actually do, which is what we do to keep track of our models. So let's start to make this a little bit more concrete. I work at Stripe. Stripe processes credit card payments. Mostly what we do on the machine learning team is fraud detection. This is the team I work with. I work with a lot of different people. This isn't all me. There's like Ryan and Michael who like train a lot of models. Michael's team lead. Dan and Danielle, who's right there, work on a lot more infrastructure. I build models too. Though the model we're talking about, I don't build. So the reason fraud is a problem is that fraud costs merchants money. So I have, since working at a credit card company, learned way more about credit card payments than I ever thought I would know. But here's a basic thing. When someone steals a credit card, they might buy a thing for $600 from like a jewelry store that uses Stripe. And then they can sell it on eBay or whatever. And then the cardholder complains to their bank and creates a chargeback, where they get the money back, right? That's how credit cards work. You know that your like credit cards are safe, even if it gets stolen. You know that your money is safe. But the person who has to give the money back is the merchant. Like, it's like the jewelry store. Fraud is a huge problem for merchants. And obviously, we want to stop that as much as possible. There are tons of transactions. There are way too many for humans to review. Therefore, we're like, machine learning! We're going to classify everything automatically. It'll be the greatest. It works. You might see some charge with like some card number and name, and maybe like the card country and the IP address and the billing address are all in different countries, and maybe you think that's like 80% likely to be fraudulent. So the first thing that people ask me, if I'm talking to like the sales team about my job, they'll be like, oh, what do you work on? I'm like, oh, I do machine learning. They're like, oh, what's that? And I'm like, well, we like classify charges. They're fraudulent. And they're like, oh. Does that work? Like, what's the fault? Should I be worried? Like, is someone going to yell at me, right? Like, they have concerns. Because we have a fraud jail that, like, will block charges that we think are fraudulent. And they want to know, like, how much of it do we catch? What's the false positive rate, right? Like, does it work? Are we doing our job? And it matters, right? Like, the credit card fraud that happens costs merchants money. If you block the wrong payments, that also costs merchants money, right? Like, you really need to get it right. And if you're building a model that you don't need to get right, it's like not totally clear why you're actually building it. Though maybe there are reasons. Right. And the whole thing is about trade-offs, right? Like, you can imagine you have some transactions which are either fraudulent or not, and then you give them some score. You're like, oh, this one's 80%, this one's 90%. And you're going to be wrong some of the time. And the trade-off is like, how often do you want to be, like how often is it okay to be wrong versus how much fraud do you want to catch? So we draw graphs like this. This is a graph that we draw. So this is like, you can imagine that over here, the false positive rate is zero because you haven't flagged anything as fraud. Also, the amount of fraud you catch is zero. And then over here, you flag everything as fraud, which is great because you catch everything and also you catch everything, right? And you really want to be somewhere in the middle, ideally somewhere with a low false positive rate, but you need to decide where you want to be on this curve. And this really depends on a lot of things, including like the merchant and how much tolerance or risk they have. Right, and we want to keep track of this, right? Like, let's say I build like 100 models. I want to know what this curve looks like for every single one of them. Who could tell me what, like, if you build models, do you know what this looks like or what something like this looks like for every model you've built in the last 6 months? Who knows that? Who wishes they knew that?
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Are you measuring the accuracy of a model by, like, the area of the space above the curve, perhaps?
No. We're measuring the accuracy. So, like, each one, like, the thing I usually care about is the accuracy at a specific threshold. Because, like, we say, like, everything above 0.9 we reject or something, right? So we don't actually, like, I don't actually care about this curve as a whole. I only care about, like, whatever points on it I pick. But I want to remember why I picked that point in the first place. So it's good to have the whole curve. So, keeping track of all this stuff is hard. You may not be doing it. I know that I didn't do it. I know that I haven't always done it. And there's a lot of stuff to keep track of. I just wrote a bunch of things here. You don't have to remember them all. But like, you might want to remember what data you trained on, or like how you split the data into a training set and a test set, or like how you transformed your features, or like what features did you use, or like some parameters to the model that you trained. And there's a lot. And who's like forgotten some of this stuff and wished that they knew? Some of you? Yeah. Yeah, right? Like, you forget because there's too much stuff to keep track of. And you can use version control. It's not really enough because, like, even if you did commit everything, you probably wouldn't want to pull all your data again and rerun the entire experiment because it would take too long. And if someone asks you, you're not going to be like, oh, like, if it takes, like, hours to reproduce it, it's a pain. And also, legitimately, I don't have that much discipline. Like, to, like, commit, like, every time I change, like, a 2 to a 3, even though maybe I should. But in practice, it turns out that I don't. So now I want to talk about some, like, bad practices in machine learning and, like, things that are mistakes. So the first bad practice is, like, not evaluating your model in any way. So you've built some model. It classifies things into, like, fraud or not fraud, and you can be like, okay, let's run it. Let's see what happens. Maybe no one will yell at me. That's a possibility. Here's a graph that I really like. So Kathy O'Neill / MathBabe is this delightful blogger and data scientist who lives in New York, and she writes a lot about bad models and models that are being used to make decisions. Like important decisions, like whether or not to fire teachers, that maybe aren't actually performing very well. So this graph is a model, I think it's called a value-added model, that's used to decide whether or not to fire teachers. So the x-axis is the teacher's performance for teaching sixth graders, and the y-axis is their performance for teaching seventh graders. Should these two things be correlated in a good model?
Yes.
Because if a teacher's a good teacher, they should be good at teaching sixth graders and also teaching seventh graders.
Not necessarily. Because not everybody actually is a good teacher in all subject matters.
In the same subject.
Even in the same subject, because it's not
okay.
The same subject. I mean, I understand what you're saying, but
yeah.
that's why a large section of people say no.
Yeah. Right. So this is a way you could evaluate this model. And maybe you think it's okay that there's no correlation, and maybe you don't. Maybe you do want this to be you. But certainly you should have, like, some evidence that this model, like, that this model is actually measuring teachers' performance in a reasonable way, right? Like, you could compare it to other models, other ways of evaluating teachers' performance, and see if it, like, correlates well with those. You should have good evidence. This to me is not good evidence that this model works. Maybe there's other evidence. Some objections, possible objections that exist are, you might say, like, we're changing our model in some way. Let's say we're adding some extra features. And you might say that you know it'll be better because you're adding stuff, and adding stuff is always better. Which isn't true. And also, even if it is better, you want to know exactly how much better it is so that then you can go to, you can say, like, wow, look what I did. Now it's like 5% better, right? Instead of it's like some unknown amount better. It takes a lot of time to evaluate models. Like, it's a lot of work. So far, it seems to me that it's the most important work. But you might feel like you don't have time. But this also means that you're doing things where you don't know if they're having any effect or not, and that takes a lot of time, right? Like, if you spend a lot of time training a new model, you want to know that it was actually worth it, and you want to know if you should keep going down that path, right? Like, if you take some direction and you evaluate it, and you're like, oh, that didn't work, then you can try something else. So I don't think you have time not to measure. I'm going to be talking about a lot of, like, generic, like, standard measures that you can use, which don't totally cover all cases. In this credit card fraud example I was talking about, I was saying that, like, making mistakes costs money, right? It costs someone money. And you might say, like, well, in that case, you shouldn't just be looking at the false positive rate. You should actually be looking at, like, how much money it's costing, right? Which is totally true. But it's definitely better to have, like, some measures than no measure at all, right? Like, you can start by having something which, like, kind of works and which convinces you that at least this is mostly okay. And then, like, as you move on, you can try to build better and better evaluations. Like, don't let the perfect be the enemy of the, like, good. So that's not evaluating your model at all, which is not the greatest thing to do, which I've definitely done before. Another one is, and this is going to be related to standardization. So sometimes I'll be building a model and, like, I'll want to, like, go onto some, like, deep investigation of, like, how it works and, like, all of the edge cases, and I'll be like, oh, there's a lot of scores of 0.8, like, why is that? Or, like, where are these false positives coming from? Is there, like, a trend in the false positives? There's something I can identify, and you'll have to do a lot of custom work, and that's, like, something you have to do, right? But if you have to do that for standard measurements, and you have to do that from scratch every time, that's a huge pain, right? Because you have to, like, wrangle that plotlib and remember how to draw, like, an R of C curve, which we're going to talk about later. And you want to be able to, like, draw like your standard measurements in a standard way, without having to do a lot of extra work. And, like, it's boring. Like, drawing the same graphs over and over again by hand is boring. Another bad practice is, which has happened to me all the time, is, like, not standardizing on a set of metrics. Because if you have two graphs, like, I have a graph from April that measures one thing, and a graph from May that measures another thing, you can't compare them, right? Like, you're like, that one looks good in a different way, so, oops. Like, which one was better? Unknown. And this has happened to me lots of times, is that I've drawn a graph, I'm like, oh no, I drew the wrong graph. Now I forgot. I can't draw the other graph. Well, that sucks. Like, this is a lot like what Sasha was talking about in her talk before lunch, right? Where, like, you throw away your data and you're like, oops. Oh, well. And standardizing forces you to, like, sit down and what metrics you actually care about, which is super great. Like, we just talked about, and, like, Sasha talked about throwing away your data, really sucks if you like draw a graph and then like delete it because it was a long time ago. That's a reasonable thing to do, but it also means that you've forgotten like where you came from and you can't compare your work now to your work before, which is really bad in a long-term project. Like this project of classifying credit cards is something we've been working on for like a year, right? So we have models that are like, that have existed for a long time, and we really want to know if like the work we're doing now is improving things and how much it's improving things. And if it stopped improving things, we would want to know because maybe we should stop working on it. And maybe the things that we have now are fine. Okay. So here are a few things that we've said. We've said like, oh, evaluating your model should be easy. If it's not easy, no one's gonna do it, right? Like, if it's like this like super long thing to like create like graphs that tell you whether your model is any good, like it's actually not going to happen. Because people are lazy. Are you lazy?
Yes.
Also, bringing up the old data should be easy because otherwise you're not going to do it. Like, you're going to be like, oh, whatever, it's okay, I'm sure it's better. Like, whatever. And you don't want that to happen. You want it to be easy. You want to standardize your metrics so that you can, which makes it easy, and which makes it easy to compare. You want to not throw away your old data. And you want to make it easy to compare different models from like the past and the present to prove to everyone that you're awesome and they should totally be paying you lots of money to do this. Okay, so this is where I stop like lecturing you about my opinions. And where I talk to you about like what we actually do at Stripe, right? Because I hate it when people lecture me about their, like, oh, you should totally remember everything forever. And I'm like, great, thanks. Like, I know, right? I would love that. But what do we actually do? What we actually do is pretty simple. So I looked at our system for this, and I found that we have 139 models, which is a lot. They're not all like real models that we're using. Some of them were just experiments where we tried something out. And we're like, oh, did that work? And then we're like, oh, no, it didn't work. Whatever, right? So some are experiments, some are real. We have a standard across all of them. And I can look up how well a model performed from the past just by clicking somewhere. And this is the greatest. And it doesn't tell me everything. Like, if I have, like, if I want to know, like, some, like, very specific thing, it won't tell me that. But it'll give me, like, a set of standards that I can refer to. So that's what we really have. I'm going to show you what it looks like, and then I'm going to tell you how we implemented it. And then I open-sourced it an hour ago. So you could actually use it if you want. So, here's what it looks like. It's called Stripe's Next Top Model. and this is what it looks like when you go there. You go to, like, the internal top model server, and it'll show you a bunch of names of models. You can see that they're named in various ways, right? Mostly someone was like, what should I call this? Okay, I'll call it Card Only Model 2014-07-07, right? Which is fine. Like, you name it as well as you can. Some of them are made, the brushfire ones are made using this, like, distributed machine, like, distributed decision tree learning framework that we also open sourced recently called brushfire. Some of them are just trained in Python. They come from all kinds of different places. And when you click on one, you see something that looks like this. There's a bit more stuff than this, but I wanted to get it all on one page. So you'll see, like, some graphs, you'll see a precision recall curve. I'm gonna talk a bit about more of these graphs later, because I really love graphs, and I would like to tell you my feelings about these graphs. Right. So you'll have like a precision recall curve, an ROC curve, some more curves, there'll be some notes, and that's it. And the page is kind of like laid out the same way. And this allows you to do great things. So, what this means is every time someone discusses a model, someone would be like, oh, let's add some new features. Here's the link for this model on top model. And here's like the comparison for all of them. And then that means that when you're having a discussion about like whether or not we should switch to using this model, it makes it a lot easier to have that discussion, right? Because you can look at a comparison like this and be like, oh, like we're proposing that we switch to this model. Well, obviously, we should switch to that model from this one. That one's way better, right? Like, it makes it a lot easier to have that conversation. And that's kind of like the dream, right? Is where you can just show someone a link and you're like, we should do this. And they're like, obviously, we should do that. So here's how it works. It's super simple. It's not like a magical like system full of magic. It's like a server that knows how to draw some graphs. It's also language independent. You can, like we train models using various languages like Scala and Python. And you can evaluate all of them. So, standards, right? You can't do anything about that. So the only kinds of models we know how to evaluate here are binary classifiers, because that's basically what we built. So a binary classifier is you're trying to classify something as true or false. So you store the target value, and you store the score that your model gave that value. And that's it. You store it in a CSV, in a TSV file. And then this is great, because if you change your mind about how you want to evaluate the model, you can change your mind, right? You can draw a new graph. If you find a bug in your graph, you can fix the code, which is amazing. The other thing you want to do is store some metadata, like all of this stuff that you might conceivably want to know. And I struggled for a long time with this, and I was like, how do I store all this, like, there's all these things, and I don't know what fields I want, like, what if I change my mind about the fields I want later, and, like, how do we build this? So I decided to do something simple, which is make a file called notes.txt, and just put stuff in that file, right? And we can say, like, oh, how did we filter the data, what were the feature importances, when we trained this feature, right? And you just write stuff. We often like automatically upload things to this note.txt file, but it's like it's just an unstructured file that tells you what you need to know, and it works well. It works better than I expected it to. So we put everything in S3. The way you put it in S3 is you have the model name, and then you put a file called scores.tsv, and you put a file called notes.txt, and that's it. And it's a lot better than nothing. It's a lot better than nothing. What?
What's S3?
Good question. It's something from Amazon. It's like a Amazon service where you can put files and keep them forever. Yeah, it's somewhere just to make the data persist so that it's like not on your computer. It could be really anywhere. Like it could be on any server. Yeah. So. I promised you I'd tell you about some of the graphs, because I really like graphs. Here's the precision recall curve. So this is, the x-axis is the precision. The precision is like, out of all of the things that you flagged as fraudulent, how many of them were really fraudulent? So over here, it's like really high, like almost all of them are fraudulent. Over here, it's really low. And then the recall is like, how many of the bad guys did you catch, right? So you can see, like, you can catch all the bad guys, but your precision will be bad, or you can catch, like, a few of the bad guys, like 40%. 40% is a lot, and with very good precision. This model is, like, a great model, right? Like, 40% recall and, like, 90 whatever percent precision is great. There's also the ROC curve, which I'm going to tell you a story about, because I thought I totally understood this graph. And then my colleague Stephen Noble told me that I totally didn't, and that there were all kinds of more magical things that I could know about it. So, ROC curve. It's the false positive rate. So the false positive rate is out of all of the, there are a lot of things that aren't fraud, and like how often were you wrong, right? So like how many good things did you like misclassify? And the true positive rate is how many bad things did you classify correctly? So you can see that like if you want, yeah. Like, so a false positive rate of like 20% is really bad because you're like flagging like 1 in 5 things where you shouldn't. But then you would catch like 90% of everything. But the cost is too high. And the cool thing about this graph is imagine that this graph was a straight line. So if you build a random classifier that just makes all of its decisions at random, this graph will be a straight line. And I talked before about picking a threshold, right? Like, you want to pick a point on this graph to be on. And if the graph is a straight line, where do you want to be? Like, do you want to be, like, here, or do you want to be in the middle, or do you want to be at the end?
It doesn't matter.
Yeah. And it does matter, in a sense, because, like, you'll have different false positives, right? But what that's also telling you is that, like, you're not getting any new information at any point along the graph. Like, you're, like, the rate of things that you're catching here is, like, the same as the rate of things that you're catching here. And you're just kind of making a meaningless decision if it's a straight line. But what that also means is if you have a regular R-seeker from, like, a real model, and part of it is a straight line, that you shouldn't pick a threshold on a straight line part of it. You should pick a threshold at, like, an inflection point, right? Like, maybe, like, maybe this isn't really straight, right? Like, maybe, like, here or something. And that kind of blew my mind, because I was like, oh, I should be looking for the inflection points in this graph. Maybe you all already knew that, but I didn't know that. So... this is another one of my favorite graphs recently. So let's say you predict that a charge, that something is 80% likely to be bad, right? And you look at all of the things that are that you think are 80% likely to be bad, and then you look at how many of them are really bad. You would expect it to be 80%, right? And sometimes it really won't be. Like, so you can compare, like, the expected rate to the actual rate. And you kind of expect that to be a straight line if you, like, think of your score as being a probability. And if it is a straight line, then that's great, because it means that the way you think about your model as a probability is correct. If it's not a straight line, it's something like this, which it totally can be, then it's, like, really good to know that. You can draw the distribution of all the scores, which is, it's good to know, like, what scores... things in your data set are being given. And those are all the graphs that I have to show you. We keep track of our models in a few other ways. We, like, log all of the choices, like all of the decisions that are made forever, which is pretty useful. We also do some manual, like, we manually review some transactions that come out of the models to make sure that, like, everything seems mostly reasonable. Like, we'll look at a very small random sample and look at, like, 30 things, and we're like, do those scores, do those decisions make sense? Has anything gone terribly wrong? So we have a few ways to do that. This is mostly all I have to say. I learned a few things that made me happy. Like, don't throw away your data. I think it keeps coming back to that, right? It's better to not throw away your data. And, like, having something that works is better, like, than having something that's perfect. And having, like, simple solutions that are, like, not very complicated is better than no solution. And storing stuff forever is awesome. And it means that we kind of have, like, some approximation of the dream, right? Like, someone can say, like, oh, here's a comparison, and, like, the one on the right is better, and we should use it, and we should switch to it. And, like, these people are all really great. And you could use it. It's on GitHub. It's at github.com/drape/top-model. It's a thing in Python. Yeah, that's all. Does anyone have questions? There are questions.
How do you compare your real-world data to your model?
It's a very good question. The short answer is that it's really hard to do. Because we have training data which is well labeled, our real world data is not well labeled. So one of the most important things we do, like the two things I mentioned before are important, like logging the choices that we make so that if we think that there's a problem, we can investigate it. Yeah, it's very hard to review if you don't have a source of truth. So doing the manual review really helps us to have, like, a small random sample. Like, the manual review is the closest thing that we do. Yeah.
For example, a fraudulent transaction, do you go and see what you think of it when it was approved?
Yeah, so what we do is we like sample a small set of the model's choices and review them and then say like it'll say, I think this is fraudulent, and you'll say like, I think that too. And you can compare what you think its accuracy is by like looking at a small sample of its choices to like what you thought its accuracy was when you trained it. And try to make sure that matches up. Yes.
Your training data set versus the real world data. Is your training data set like historical data of fraudulent transactions?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you guys do the whole 50-50 thing where you split or some sort of portion or whatever and take that out from the training and that?
Yeah. Yeah, when I say training data, I mean we split it up into training set and test set, and then we like store the evaluations on the test set.
Okay.
Yeah.
That makes this question.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yes.
How far back does your data go?
All forever. Like, yeah.
Since the dawn.
Yeah, since Stripe started processing transactions. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
So we think about it, like how we think about like, mostly we really want there to be a low false positive rate, because I think in practice that's what like merchants really care about that, right? Okay. Like if you see like, oh, we're gonna like have a false positive rate of like 2%, right? And 2% of your transactions are going to be like flagged as fraudulent when they're not, like that's not really acceptable. Yeah.
And then I guess in terms of allocating like data science just time, like how do you think about that? That's like, how are you measuring, like are you making a meaningful improvement to be worth the cost of your data science team?
You should ask my manager. I don't know if I have a good answer for that. Yeah. Yes.
Situations where if you're developing a new model, you're working off new features that you didn't have before, mm-hmm. trying to compare. So if you're comparing models and the data that you had and the models that you ran off before ran off of a certain set of features and your new models run off of a slightly different,
mm-hmm.
are you just going off the curves to compare those models at that point?
Yeah, like if you're training them on the same data, like on the same like time range of data, then it makes sense to compare models using different features, right? Like if the like training set of charges is like from like December to March and then you test it on like March to April or something, right? Then if you use different features, you're still comparing like apples and apples, if that makes sense.
Are you able to take something like to take your new model and run it off the old data even though you don't have features?
Yeah. Yeah. Like we can still run it on the same data set just with new features, like just by calculating new features. Yeah.
Sorry. So do you have a situation where your features are not in the data set that you're
using? Oh, yes. Yeah, that happens. And then you need to think about it. So like one thing you could do is you can just like not, like let's say there's a new feature that we started getting, right, like in April, then you could compare the model. Like you could generate the old features and generate the new features for the same time period and then compare them, for instance. Yeah, it's a service. I can show you how it works. I can give you like a really fast demo. I think I have time. Because demos always totally work, right? Nope. Let's try again. Okay, yeah. So like I start like topmodelserver.py. And then I go visit it in my browser, and then it shows me a bunch of models. These are just like example data, and I can either like say like here compare these two.
That's your terminal, right?
Hmm. Over here. Like I started it from my terminal. Uh-huh. Yeah, but this is just running in a browser. Yeah. So I can compare two models, or I can just go to a model and look at like its performance. Yeah, sure. I started it by running dot slash top model server dot py. Okay. Yeah.
So where's the autocomplete coming from?
That's my shell.
So what are some of the easier ways you have found saving your data? So you've gone through, you've cleaned it, you've changed something. How do you, you know, just store your data somewhere that's not in necessarily original storage?
Which kind?
So let's say your data came from a database.
Yeah.
You did some filtering and you want to save the data in order to rerun the model on it or in order to run another model.
So we store, like, all of our original data is in HDFS, like in Hadoop. And we do a lot of our feature generation as MapReduce jobs, which are version controlled. So like doing a training is like, we'll get the data set out of Hadoop and then we'll have like a script that filters it. So we try not to keep too much like state, right? Because you don't want to be like, have like a data set that's like only on your machine that you forget how you generated. Yeah, so all of the transformations are like version controlled somewhere. Is that helpful? Yes.
Oh, for top model?
Yeah.
For like a new model, do you only have to give it the list of scores and like probabilities?
Yeah.
It just generates everything?
Yeah, it generates everything. As long as it's a binary classifier. If it's not a binary classifier, it doesn't know what to do. It does one thing. yes.
For different versions, different models might work sort of better.
Yeah.
Like, do you kind of look into that somehow?
Yeah. So when we don't actually have one model, we have a lot of models. And we use them for different purposes. Yeah. Yes.
So let's say you take some data for some year, right, and you build some model, and then you receive new data. Would you ever use the exact same procedure for rebuilding a new model, like from the new data using the exact same approach, or do you still have to stay with it for a month to approve? Or can you just make it automatically regenerate the model every time you get new data?
This is a complicated question. So you're asking if like it makes sense to retrain your model automatically when you get new data?
Yes.
Right. This is something that we don't do. I really like being able to know what the performance is of a model. I'm like getting. Training on a model on new data that might have different characteristics, so where it might perform differently, and then like deploying it automatically seems dangerous to me. Yeah. This is something that like merits a larger conversation, though.
Yeah. Probably not so much an issue, right? It depends on the behavior more, right?
Yeah.
Like how much people like it, like doing fraud, how much they like it coordinating with each other to challenge their dependence.
Yeah. 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 Are there any more questions? Okay, awesome. Thanks for coming.